Hi guys, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. It's a pleasure to have you guys back. It's been a while. I've had to take a week off as I was starting to work on my PC. My main and only PC, unfortunately, was giving me some trouble, so I couldn't actually do any recording. But now that's all sorted, I am so keen to get back into it, and I'm excited to be here. We're going to be trying something a little bit new today. We're going to be going by the requests that the community has been putting in for us in our Discord. Now, if you're not sure, our Discord is a pretty live community. There's a lot of people in there with some great knowledge. And if you're interested, the link in the description is always there so that you can join. And thanks to their suggestions, we've got a couple today that we're going to be doing. In today's video, we're going to be going through tuning your Plex. There's many settings in Plex. There's many different options. But we're going to show you how we like to do it here at IBRACORP. We've been using Plex as our main media server for up to 30 users for pretty much close to 3 years now. On top of that, we're also going to be looking at RAM transcoding. So we're going to get you set up on your Unraid server so that you can use your RAM to help with transcoding content. And this allows you to reduce those read writes to your disk and have them running in your RAM instead. So if that sounds interesting and you want to learn more, stay with us and let's get into it. Okay guys, so we're going to assume that you've got Plex installed, but you want to make the fine-tuning changes that we're going to show you today. So what we'll do first is we'll actually start in Unraid so that we can have our template ready, and then we can come back to Plex and we'll start fine-tuning some of those settings. So let's head back to our Unraid server and we'll go from there. So here we are, we're on our main server Zeus. So we'll head over to our Docker tab. Once you're in your Docker tab, look for your Plex install. In my scenario here, I'm actually using the official Plex Media Server container, and that seems to work really well. So I've just been using that forever, basically, so I have no need to really change it. If you watched our hard linking video, there is some changes that you will have to make if you haven't already. And the main one is where you map your media to. So as you can see here, we've got a media mapping to /data/media. And then over here in the host path, it's going to our user, data, and media folders. So if you're not aware, that's the first thing that you should probably change. And that just allows you to have that content come up and utilize your hard linking features. So that's all explained in our hard linking video if you're interested in that. Under show more settings here, there is a change that I would like to recommend, and I learned this from the community as well. So by default, you'll have MNT:\user/appdata. That works fine, but the amount that Plex actually pumps in and out of that folder, you're actually better off having it sitting on the cache so that it's always on the cache. And then when you don't need it anymore, you can just blow that away if you need to. So pretty much really easy, just change it from user. As you can see in this folder here, it's usually user. We're just going to change that to cache. All right, so just have that as cache and you should be fine. And that way we can always make sure the config's there. Don't worry if it's an existing setup. Nothing's going to happen if you do that. It might re-trigger a couple of scheduled tasks, but you'll be fine. Now, the part you can't see here is where we do our RAM transcoding. Now, there's different methods, and I've been searching and I found that there's different ways people do this. I'm going to show you the way that I've decided to go with, and it's been working for me now. I've tested for about a month or so. So in the container template, just go to advanced view up in the top right corner here. Once you've got the advanced view, scroll down to extra parameters. Now, if you followed other guides, or maybe you already knew this, but if you're trying to use your CPU in order to do the transcoding for you as a graphics option, then you need to have this first part in there, the --device=dev/DRI. And that allows it to actually tap into the CPU and use that. All we're going to add then next to this is --mount:\tmpfs:\tmpfs-size=, and then a size in bytes. So the first thing I'll let you know is the size in bytes that you're going to have to put here is going by your server. On my server here, for example, I've got 48 gigabytes of RAM. So what this number converts to is about 20 gigs. And then after that, another important one is this --no-health check. Now back to the RAM transcoding thing here. So I'll just explain to you what's happening. So basically we are telling it to mount a directory, and we're saying the directory is --tmp. So make sure you note that down because we're gonna have to put that in Plex when we get to Plex. Now once done with all that, you can just apply it and restart the container. So in the background, it'll actually now map that location for us. So that's pretty much it in here. Once you've made those changes, we can now go into Plex and we'll start going through Plex's settings and we'll fine tune it together. So let's go ahead and do that. Okay guys, so the first tab we're going to start on here is remote access. Now as you can see in remote access, we have a port that we've designated in Plex to say this is the port we want to communicate on the public port, so that if we're coming in from the outside of our network, hit us on 32400. Now by default it's 32400, you have the option to change that and customize anything you like. If you're not sure how to do that, I will be doing a video with our unified dream machine. We're going to do a review on that since it's been close to a month now using that, so I'll be walking through how to do all the ports and a bunch of other networking stuff as well. So once you've got that, then you go into your internet upload speed. So what's your maximum upload speed, or the speed that you want to set for Plex to be the maximum? Now in my case it's 40 megabytes per second, and then I'll set the remote stream to 20 megabytes per second. So I don't want to go any higher than that per stream. As you can see here, Plex will say it'll operate within this boundary. So pretty straightforward. Once you have all that stuff set up, move on. But if you're having trouble with the remote access, don't always rely on this little green tick or this telling you that it's working. Sometimes it'll say it's not working, but it actually is. So if you were to retry it, it'll probably work. Always best to test on your phone, you know, take it off the Wi-Fi and just check it on your 4G or 5G, whatever it is. And in our library here, we've got a few options to go through. So let's have a look. Scan my library automatically, that's fine. So if you were to add one file, it'll just scan through Plex. Run a partial scan when changes are detected. Again, when it detects a change, it will do that. We're not doing music libraries for mine, but yours may be different. Scan your library periodically. So I have it at least once a day just to go ahead and do that. Now here's one of the important ones that I learned from our member Disc Duck over on Discord. With this option here, if you untick it, and you make changes and that file is no longer around or the metadata has changed, Plex will actually show you a red trash icon over the items, indicating that the item is either can't be found or doesn't exist anymore. This is actually very useful when you are doing very, very large changes on your file server for Plex or moving your media around. Now, for example, I went through an operation where I basically renamed all the files using Sonar and Radar. Every file that you change, Plex considers that a new file or a new media content. So what it does is it deletes what it previously had and now enters this new one as if it was a new item that's been added. The problem with that is it then triggers other jobs such as creating thumbnails. If you have the video thumbnails, it will probably trigger that too. Skipping intro feature, so it'll generate all that stuff again. When we don't really want that. That's just gonna take up server resource, and I learned that the hard way. Basically, my server was stuck for about a day and a half as it continued its work. What is recommended actually is you come in here, you untick this, hit save, and then go make your mash changes to your server. Do whatever you have to do. When you're done, come back and click empty trash automatically after every scan. Then when the scan runs, it'll actually say, oh, okay, this file is gone, but then it finds it straight away. So that's a handy tip for you. If you're making mash changes, I really recommend you do this. It will save you a lot of heartache and a lot of stress on your server. Once you're done, turn it back on, and then, you know, small changes and that can be managed by Plex a lot more easily. So we'll just leave it back to what it was. I personally do not use video preview thumbnails. I don't find them that useful. For example, you know, if you mouse over the thumbnail for my video here, you'll see that YouTube will show you little chapters in there. And that just takes up more space and CPU usage. So it's really up to you. The intro video markers is definitely something I like to do, which is pretty handy. Generate chapter thumbnails, I leave that as a scheduled task. Audio tracks for loudness as a scheduled task as well. And the location visibility. So this will have metadata for your location. I like my privacy, so I'll set that to admin only. That's your library settings there done. And just remember, we've got show advanced up here ticked in the right corner, guys. So if you're not seeing these options, that's probably why. So just make sure you show advanced options. So under network, we've got a few options and we don't need to change too much. Probably the most important one here is maximum remote stream. So if you're having a few people that you've invited to your server, family and friends, you might want to limit how many individual accounts can stream at the same time. And that just helps avoid account sharing and things like that. So for my users, I'm happy for them to have two, depends what works for you. Custom server access, that's our URL that we have configured. So that if we wanted to hit our Plex directly, we can actually just go to that address. Transcoder. And this is going to be the big money maker right here. In the transcoder settings, you'll see this transcoder temporary directory /TMP. That's what we mapped in the container template in the extra parameters field. So we're just going to put the exact same thing, which is /TMP, which is already there for me. That way Plex will use that directory. And you notice it says that it's for temporary files. So the beauty of it is Instead of writing all those individual temporary files to your cache or to your array, then you're going to send them all the way back and then they're just going to be deleted. Cut down on that read write, or, you know, all that wear and tear on your system can basically be avoided. So in our case, we're just going to set that to TMP. That way Plex will just write it to the RAM and it will sit in the RAM and it's got instant access to it. And it also just cuts it off when it doesn't need it anymore. I've got the Transcoder default throttle buffer here set to 120 seconds, so basically 2 minutes. And that means that I'll allow it to buffer 2 minutes ahead and then it'll throttle down so that it's not constantly throttling up on your CPU if you had to do that. The background transcoding, I've got it on medium at the moment. Enable HDR tone mapping is checked. If you are using your CPU for transcoding, make sure you check the use hardware acceleration when available. Now, I believe this is a Plex Pass feature, so if you don't have Plex Pass, you may not have this option or you may not be able to select it, but it's basically one of the most important features there is, because using your CPU to transcode is immensely helpful. Same goes for video encoding. And then we have the maximum simultaneous transcodes. So there is a lot of misunderstanding on transcoding and direct plays. What this option is saying is you can have 15 people using the transcode option while they are watching. So if their client that they're using, TV or Xbox or whatever it might be, doesn't natively support the format of the media content, it will then become transcoded and Plex will change it on the fly to match the client so that they can watch it. That is considered a transcode. The alternative is the client supports it fully, in which case then it is a direct play or a direct stream, and that is not counted as part of this number. So just something important to remember, this is only referring to transcodes. And the reason why is because that's going to be the most intensive part of any media streaming on your CPU, is the transcodes. The direct plays actually have little, no impact. The only impact a direct play will have is on the actual bandwidth, which is much more easier to manage. So often I'll actually ask my users to make sure that their quality is at full or as high as possible. And that's because it puts less strain on my server. So once you've got all that, hit save. Then you have extras. Now this is a pretty cool one. I actually put off using it for quite a while. But as you can see here, you can actually put your own pre-roll video. And I'm pretty sure this might be, these guys here are Plex Pass. This one, I don't think it is, maybe. But basically, I've put one of my video intros into my movies folder, and I've mapped it like so. And I'll show you what that looks like here. If we just go to one, and we'll go with this one here. As you can see, this is my pre-roll video right now. And Plex plays that automatically before the start of the movie, and then it'll start kicking off the movie. So pretty impressive. If we go back to settings now, if you go down to libraries, you've got your libraries there. So obviously if you guys have watched my hard linking video and you've made changes to where the directories are for your content, you need to modify them here. So under folders, you can see /data/media/movies. So we can make sure it's looking in the right location. And you want to make sure you do that for all of those. So guys, that's my Plex settings. I hope that helps you guys get yourself sorted and get some RAM transcoding going. Your life will change once you do it. It really, really reduces the impact on your server and on your disks. So they'll be thanking you later for it. So make sure you get out there and you give it a go. I think it's well worth it. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give us a like and subscribe. Really appreciate it. Share it around if you can. And we'll see you in the next IBRACORP video. Just wanted to let you know about our website that we are operating in conjunction with our YouTube channel. Our website allows us to post our content up straight away, and members can actually get their content straight to their inbox. This is really useful. It helps us communicate with you guys a little bit better. It's very easy to use. And it's pretty clean in my opinion. I think you guys would really enjoy it. And any sort of member really helps us out. So just by subscribing to our channel, you're helping us out. But if you were interested and you wanted to help support us a little further, on our membership page, you can pick an option that suits you. And from there, you can decide how you would like to support us. If you would just like to go with the free plan, that's perfectly fine too. With the free plan, you'll still get all the stuff sent to your inbox so that you don't even have to wait for YouTube to tell you. They'll just be there ready for you in a nice, easy to read format. Sometimes we do actually post written stuff as well. So if you are enjoying our content, you really want to help support us a little bit extra, just to put in a little bit more, please, you're more than welcome to come over to our website, ibracorp.io. In the portal page, you'll find all of our most useful links as well to help you navigate all of our different products and services that we offer. Thanks very much, and let's get back into it.